and gentlemen, let's welcome our visitors, the Amarillo Bombers. Number 4, forward, Sam Webb. Number 7, goalkeeper, Fredo Chavez. Number 10, midfielder, David Trevizo. Number 12, defender, Felipe Baez. Number 14, forward, Connor Goldberg. Number 15, midfielder, Jorge Gonzalez. Number 16, midfielder, Sally Calderon. Number 18, defender, Kevin Alvarez. 19, defender, Jorge Miller. Number 20, midfielder and goalkeeper, Benji Montreal. Number 21, defender, Alan Valenzuela. He's got a crowd. Number 23, defender, Kevin Machado. Forward, number 77, Rene Loya. Midfielder, number 96, Juan Carrasco. And at your roster for the Bombers, number 99, midfielder, Jared Gonzalez, the number of the Bombers are led by Mr. Chad Webb. He's assisted by Alex Navarrete, Alvarado Sanchez, and Jay.
Welcome into Hartman Arena in Park City, Kansas, host of the MASL2 National Playoffs. We're on day three, actually day four if you count the banquet on Thursday. This is the third place game between the Wichita Wings and the Amarillo Bombers, conference opponents. The Wings have won the lion's share of those games this year, and up until last night had only lost one game on the season. That was to these Amarillo Bombers. That was in overtime in Amarillo on a doubleheader. Wichita with the three-goal lead late in that match. Amarillo goes sixth attacker, ends up tying the game late, losing in overtime. Coincidentally, the only other loss to the Wichita Wings coming last night on a game where they led with a minute and a half left, gave up a sixth attacker goal, playing shorthanded, five against the six from Rochester. They score, go into extra time, and Rochester wins that game in overtime, headed to the MASL2 final later today at 4 p.m. against the Iowa Demonhawks as the Lancers. Wichita suffers its second loss of the season. Again, two losses, both overtime losses after leading and giving up a sixth attacker goal late. Difficult loss, gut punch, if you will, for the Wichita Wings. But a quick turnaround. Wichita missing seven players from their typical roster that you would see carrying in this 18 today. A lot of injuries, a lot of difficult challenges, and even a red card last night to Kieran Lakin. Kieran Lakin out, Kaiki Trevilato out, Junior Quezada out. He's dressed and going to try to warm up, but didn't look very good. Tried to tape it. Lalo Durath out. I could go on. I'm gonna need a piece of paper to jog my memory on that. Amarillo on their second game of the weekend. We had the issue with El Paso not attending. So really, second game to the Wings three. We do have some players called up here for this match. Peter Espinoza is going to step in for the Wichita Wings, as well as Philip Wynn, Matt Sherrod, and a few others that have fresh legs. Aaron Parrott starts in goal for the Wings, and Jose Ocampo, last night's goalkeeper, is going to be available on the field. I'm alongside Chris Economides. We're at Hartman Arena. Not exactly how you want to see the Wichita Wings finish their last game of the season, but they want to come out, and these fans that showed up, to just say thank you for a good season and try to put on a performance. We'll see how this one goes for the Wichita Wings.
Well, I'll tell you, Blake, from a league perspective, I mean, I don't think we could have had two better games than we had yesterday, especially the Wings game last night. I mean, it was incredible. We had over 500 viewers watching the game live.
At any given time, I checked it this morning, and it was 6 or 7,000. I forget how many, but it
over
was
7,000.
Yeah, 7,000 views, which is great.
You know, hats off again to you and the entire Wings organization here. It's been a fantastic weekend. Obviously, from a Wichita perspective, not like how you would have liked to see the final today. But again, as always is the case, first-class Wings organization here, and should have a good match here, then followed up by a tremendous championship match between the Iowa Demonhawks and the Rochester Lancers at 4 o'clock.
When I made it into the arena this morning, somebody asked me how I felt about it, and you know, somebody's, and as I walked by, everybody had a different moment in the game that was pivotal. The Wichita Wings started slow and gave up some own goals and had these mistakes, or, you know, the referee or this foul or that foul or whatever you might, you know, be able to point at. But that's what happens when you play in those very tight overtime type games. And you know, maybe you deserve to and you didn't get a result there. But that's kind of, those are the historic games where you can point back at one or two things. And really,
well, I think
keep the fan base interested going into the next year. That's never been a problem for Wichita, but trying to gather my words on that. Still emotional. Quick turnaround for me. You and I were both here. It was a very, very emotional game late into overtime. 2 minutes left. But I think on behalf of the Wings fans, the players, the staff, the fan base, everybody handled it really well inside the arena. You know, you and I on the broadcast, we didn't go over the top with it. We'd be appreciative, and it's hard for me as a Wings supporter and grew up as a Wings fan, now part of the organization. Sometimes you take that and it's hard to swallow at first, but love the fact that they belonged and arguably were the better team and put on a great show and, you know, carry that momentum into next year.
They more than belonged, obviously. But I'll tell you, I mean, I was telling you last night, and I'll tell you again today, I've been in your shoes before as an owner of the Rochester Rhinos. I mean, I literally couldn't eat for a week, which is good. but I mean, it's a gut punch, something that you're not going to forget. It takes time, and they say time heals all wounds, but I don't know. That was one of the more. I mean, it was probably the best game so far this weekend, obviously, and the season. But it could go down as one of the, you know, iconic games in M2 history. So
it may be the best one we've seen so far in M2 history, to be honest. And
it had everything. I mean, everything is magnified 1,000-fold with what's on the line, being a semifinal, trip to the finals on the line. And I think both teams gave it their all, gave it, you know, everything they had. And I was telling you earlier, should the Iowa Demon Hogs defeat the Lancers, I think they owe you a nice steak dinner because I'll tell you what, I mean, Rochester is beaten up. They're tired. But again, you know, it's a winner-take-all scenario, and I'm sure that Jake Schindler and the Lancers are going to be ready to go today. But again, what two fantastic semifinals we had yesterday. I think it's a showcase for the league. I think it's a showcase for indoor soccer. And again, great arena, great crowd last night. Everything's been first class here.
Yeah, Rochester definitely depleted, just like this Wichita Wings team. We said six players from last night's roster not in this match for the Wichita Wings. And hopefully that's not the case for Rochester with a lot on the line, a championship game ahead of them. Sure, they'll be ready to go, but you're right. That's a almost 5-hour difference after overtime and everything that transpired, difference in recovery time for the Iowa Demon Hawks. And although they were in a close game with Amarillo, they didn't get pushed all the way to the end of the game. There was a 3-goal lead with 8-9 minutes left. They were able to open that lead up and be a little bit comfortable, start their recovery process, where Rochester didn't know they were advancing until with 2 minutes left in overtime.
Well, look at it. I mean both games yesterday, they were very similar. That both Iowa and Rochester got off to quick starts, but then both the Wings and the Bombers came back. You know, you guys were actually, the Wings were actually winning and leading, and Marillo got to within a goal. So again, putting my league hat on, I couldn't ask for anything more dramatic. Quality teams, quality soccer. I mean, and as Brian Ackley says, our the fine PR director of the league, he says that he really enjoys watching M2 over the other. Nothing against our brethren at M1, but he says that this brings him back to his youth of how the game used to be played. So again, kudos to everybody here, and it's been a great weekend.
Well, still 0-0, 9 minutes left in this first quarter, 6 minutes in, 0-0. That's Aaron Parrott for Wichita. He flicks it forward to Matt Sherrod. Sherrod heads it on to Lucio. Lucio fouled very hard there at midfield by Jorge Miller.
You mentioned Chico Borja yesterday, Blake. And one of the distinct honors that I have today is to pass out the playoff MVP. And what better person, especially here in Wichita, but what better person other than Chico Borja to have the MVP plaque named after himself?
Yeah, God bless Chico Borja. I wish, and I know that he would be here to deliver that award himself had he not passed away and been taken just a little bit too early a few years back. But yeah, no, passionate, everything you want out of a player in the community. Chico Borja always in Wichita, coaching youth, running camps, shaking hands everywhere he went. He was known, but he was in local restaurants. He would shop with his family at the same grocery store all of the time, and they were just a little bit larger than life personality, but very deeply rooted in this community and meant a ton to the indoor soccer game after leaving, when the NASL folded and he came from the New York Cosmos and came to Wichita, was a game changer and one of the most iconic players in indoor soccer history.
Well, I mean, I remember that, the first year that we took over running the M2, Andrew and Ross and myself, that we had our first championship here in Wichita 4 years ago. And I remember calling up his son and asked him, look, we want to do this with your blessing. And he was very, very emotional about it and obviously very appreciative. But as I said, I can't think of a better person and the honor that we have to be able to put his name on that plaque.
You know, it's a third place game. Alvidrez feels like he gets smacked when Lucio's trying to shield a ball with the Lucio forearm. And Amarillo gets frustrated, and then we get a little bit of foul on the back end of this. Now, they're going to call Rene Loya very close today. It didn't look like something that should have been a two-minute penalty, but it is going to be given to Loya, and it's because yesterday in that scrum, they went back and watched some video, and it was evident, but not so evident that the league had to make a call. There's a couple photos, and Loya came out of nowhere against Thiago Freitas from behind. It was a little bit too physical with Freitas. You see him coming in there on the replay prior with his arm up, but there was a strike to the back of the head of Thiago Freitas for the Iowa Demon Hawks during a scrum that ended in a red card for.
There's a goal.
The Amarillo Bombers, so they're definitely going to try to manage this game and not let it get out of control. But great ball across there from David Lucio on the Wichita Wings power play and clipped in there. Just a nice little touch on the back post for Taylor Henry, and Wichita goes up 1-0. Number 13, Taylor Henry, assisted by David Lucio.
You know, I was mentioning to you, Blake, earlier that we had, after the game last night, you know, when things had calmed down, you know, we try and, you know, spend some time with all the teams. So I had the pleasure of going into your locker room last night with head coach Roger Downing, and there was about four or five players in there. We spent about almost 2 hours in there. And it was more, you know, this is the part of the job that really is enjoyable to me. This brings me back to my Rhino days, where I had a special bond in the locker room with the guys, with the players. And I mentioned to Roger last night, you know what? When it's all said and done, this is what you're going to miss. It's the camaraderie, it's the bond, it's the friendships that you make along the way. And it was really, really enjoyable just to spend some quiet time. We had a couple of alcoholic beverages, let's say, last night. Spoke with Roger and some of the other players, and it was really, really enjoyable. Roger Downing, again, I can count on one hand the amount of people that I met in my tenure, 35 years, that I really don't care to be around. But Roger Downing, one of the nicest people, class act, and I would expect nothing less from the Wings organization.
So sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No. It was just enjoyable. You know, we all go through a lot of stress this weekend. There's a lot of things on the line. I understand that. But, I mean, last night was really, really enjoyable just to spend some time with people of Roger Downing's ilk.
And there's Roger there. You know, I will tell you, character is not a flaw for Roger Downing. That's for certain. We all have some, and, you know, he takes it difficult when the team doesn't find success. But as you can see him here smiling and laughing with David Lucio.
God bless
pushing
him.
Pushing it by. He's a great guy, and some of his best friends here in Wichita, he's from Dayton, Ohio, is now Kevin Tenai, Daniel Sack, Jared Robbins. Oddly enough, you know, he didn't know those guys before the Wichita Wings, and what I knew about Roger is he came in, he's a trainer, had a gym, played at Wright State University as a player, left, went overseas, had some second team time with Newcastle. Most people don't know that about Roger. Had a head injury, found himself in a difficult place, came back, went to Dayton, where he originally had lived for a while, and playing at Wright State in Ohio as well. Met his wife, Lindsay, there. Her family was from Wichita, and he was running a gym. And he said, you know what, let's start a family. Let's go back.
Oh.
Good save by Freda Chavez as he almost gives Juan Zamora an easy one for Wichita to go up 2-0, still 1-0. But Roger had came to Wichita, and he's like, well, I still want to be around the game. So he took a high school coaching job, happened to be a coaching job on where my son went to high school.
So what happened was
I started to talk to Roger, and I just met him as a person and really enjoyed the conversation. I felt like he was genuine. I felt like he cared about the players. He had a very unique perspective of the game, because not only playing for Wright State and playing a little bit of indoor. Well, I didn't know that at the time, the indoor, but playing at a high level and then also running a gym and understanding recovery and physical regimens. And I said, hey, you know, I don't know what you know about the Wichita Wings, but we're bringing back the Wichita Wings. And I really think you'd be a great guy because, you know, there's so much hard work and recovery and just will yourself to play in this indoor game. Mm-hmm. Then do you know much about it? And he said, actually, as David Trevizio, great left-footed shot, beats Aaron Parrott to the left. He says, Downing says, yeah, you know, actually I played a little bit for the Dayton, Ohio. So we start going through that. Had some similar ideas. Obviously didn't play at the level of, you know, the the Rochester Lancers, Wichita Wings, and Cleveland Crunch, and some of the teams he's been a part of now. Now he's coached James Togba, Frank Tayu, Uzi Tayu, Kevin Tenayk, and more, right? Benji Monreal, some big names even in the M1 markets. But what I knew was that if I could sit him down at the time with Brian Perez, who had just left the Kansas City Comets as a captain there and was coming to Wichita to run the program for FC Wichita as a technical director, played for the Wichita Wings and Comets guy, Futsal World Cup, Kevin Tenayk, Futsal World Cup, U.S. national team, big name, played not only the Comets, but obviously the Wichita Wings and just a big part of Wichita soccer, Kevin. So we sat down, introduced him to these guys, said, hey, I want you guys to meet. I think it's important that we all push this team in the right direction. And Roger got along great with them. They all, in the first year, gave input. They were players, Tenayk and Perez, but they helped him galvanize himself into the local soccer market for indoor, and Roger's taken it and ran with it. These guys love him, and they play hard for him, and you saw it right there with he and Lucio on the bench going back and forth, laughing and talking, even after a hard loss yesterday. Amarillo's going to take a 2-1 lead right now after a Bombers goal from Juan Carrasco. Another left-footed strike. Trevizio hit his as we were talking about Downing. And this one, you can see Carrasco just catches Parrott leaning a little bit right and comes back across his body. That's 2-1 in favor of the Amarillo Bombers. 5 minutes, 32 seconds left in the first quarter.
You know, I know that we're rambling a little bit here, Blake, but I mean, you know.
No, I guarantee there's Wings fans that are watching this that have never heard that story because I've never told it before.
Well, you know, what's special to me is, you know, the impact, and you don't realize it until years down the road, but the impact that, you know, you as an owner here, you know, myself in Rochester with the Rhinos, that you have on people's lives. We literally change people's lives. I'll give you three examples. Like in Rochester, you know, Dougie Miller met his wife and settled down in Rochester, had a very successful post-career there. Craig Demon, another one of my ex-players, one of the finest people that I've ever had the privilege of knowing. You know, Billy Andrecki met his wife and settled down in Rochester. Now you mentioned Roger here. You know, it really is special knowing that you've had a small dose of impacting people's lives like that, and
it really means everything. And that's why I brought the story up, is you were saying that what you remember when it's all said and done is those relationships and those bonds. And
exactly.
And even now where we're at from this vantage point, you think back of when you started, when you're with Rochester as an owner, when you know, you're a player or what have you, the people that you lean on today and the people that we build our organization and franchise and relationships around are those people that we had good experiences with, or that we fought with, that we bled with, or that we suffered with. And that's exactly the point. Brian Perez mentioned him before. He came back and helped us, you know, bring Roger, bring Kevin, bring Brian, bring all of these guys together. Jared Robbins was an FC Wichita player. I coached him in the U.S. Open Cup, brought him in after his college days to FC Wichita, and then he was introduced to me. A lot of these guys here were brought together for that, and they're just great, great friends now. And, you know, being a part of a community, being able to put your roots down, Brian Perez did that. Played in Wichita in 2010, 2011, got traded to Syracuse, went to the Milwaukee Wave, went and became a huge part of Kansas City, but he came from Kansas City, was born in Costa Rica, went to Miami, got recruited by UMKC, graduated there, all-time leading goal scorer, all-time leading shots, caps, all this, ends up playing the indoor game in Wichita after training with the Comets, signs a rookie deal with the Wings, 2 years, starts being a traveling guy. But we had built a good relationship in his couple years as a friendship. So I always told him, when you retire, you're welcome here. And he ended up meeting his wife, Jamie. They have two beautiful kids.
There you go.
He now coaches Friends University's college. He's a technical director for FC Wichita. His kids are in the local youth clubs. And he's just a huge part of our community. And it goes back to friendships we had when Brian was 22, 23 years old.
And there you go. And you know what? Not to toot our own inner circle here, but, you know, for the most part, you know, soccer players, and obviously arena soccer players in general, you know, they're not these prima donnas. They're not, you know, some of these athletes that think, you know, they're God's gift. They're down-to-earth people. They're just like, you know, the average person. They're good people. And it's good to hear these stories about the impact we've had on these people's lives.
These guys, they're not counting the money they made playing soccer.
No.
Most of them are counting the memories and the love for the game. They want to play. They want to play in front of passionate fans. They want an environment that's conducive with professionalism. And I think that's why so much talent and so many of these guys come to Wichita, want to play and then settle down, is because it's easy living, as you know, from driving from point A to point B. You can get across town in minutes. You don't have to live your life in traffic. The roads are clean, they're wide open, there's three, four lanes everywhere, and that's one of those things, is you don't spend a lot of time in the car. The people here are truly nice and caring, and I'm sure it's like that in markets such as Rochester as well, where you have a guy like Sam who's willing to invest and spend time and grow that market, but at the same time, the Doug Millers and the Schindlers and these guys have made their life there.
You know, you bring up the people of Wichita. I'll tell you, being from upstate New York, it's okay, but like being from a big city, the people here have been just so kind. And it's genuine, you know. There's nothing fake about it. Everybody's welcoming. Everybody's, you know, been very, very polite and kind. And you know, it takes, you know, an upstate New Yorker, a day or so, just to get acclimated to the.
Yeah, is that sarcasm or is that guy actually nice? Not
exactly.
Everybody's nice, but you know, even in moments of extreme controversy, it does seem like we have people that try to solve problems.
No,
you know, on an even keel, and hopefully all the players. I've had a lot of players come up and staff members from different teams say, hey, thanks, everything's great, it's been great so far, we love the venue, we love the environment, and that's due to the staff. That's not just you or I sitting up here talking. There's some amazing people around us helping right now.
You know, you mentioned some of the other teams. A guy like Dr. J.B. Parker, him and Coach Chad Webb from Amarillo, you know, you couldn't find two nicer people. You know, class acts, you know, another tough loss yesterday, but you know what? Smile on their face, very, very polite. I wish I had some of their traits when I had my, there were very few down moments with the Rhinos, but you know, we lost some tough games, and I made a complete ass out of myself certain times. But here, everybody's been, you know, you see the guys from Orlando, and Donovan Roper, and Alex Flores. You see Dr. Parker, you know, he's, you know, you see, you know, Darwin Salas. Everybody has just been fantastic.
Speaking of Dr. Parker and these Amarillo Bombers, he and Chad Webb have continued to grow and build. The Bombers started alongside Stephanie Tucker, who's no longer a partner there. It's a little bit different era. They've moved into this league years ago and continued to get better and better. They've always been a top of the league in goals and standings, and they've invested and they've continued to bring in quality players. You see Rene Loya here pressuring for a ball. We've seen Benji Monreal and Juan Carrasco. That added to the Fredo Chavez, added to the Conrad Goldborns, added to the Alvarez and the players that have been there since the beginning. It's really, truly exciting to watch them. If you're an Amarillo fan, you're watching from back home, this team is invested in your community. Find a way to talk to your employers, your coworkers, your company, and support this group. They have a lot of bright things ahead in their future. So good luck to them for right now for the MASL2 playoffs. We're going to take a media timeout here during the break, first and second quarter, 2-1 Amarillo Bombers.
At IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes. With our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more, there's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
Yeah, we just had a
Sorry about that. Had a microphone malfunction. We're back at Hartman Arena in Park City, Kansas with the MASL2 playoffs. Day four, banquet day one. Quarterfinals day two on Friday. Semifinals and a lot of action last night as these two teams here in the 1 p.m. Central time. Third place game, second year in a row Wichita and Amarillo met in the third place game. Last year that result going to the Wichita Wings. Both teams understand no game is overlooked as not important because these guys are competitors and they want to play hard, but not the same type of intensity certainly we would see if this was a final. Wichita coming off a very difficult loss last night, leaving the arena after 10 o'clock at night and an overtime loss to the Rochester Lancers after trailing all game. The Wichita Wings taking a one-goal lead late in that match, giving up a sixth attacker goal with a minute and a half left to the Lancers. Lancers winning with 2 minutes left in overtime on a golden goal. Now Wichita back but injured, missing the likes of Kaiki Trevilato, Carlos Vidrio, Kieran Lakey, who's serving a red card suspension, Junior Quisada, Lalo Giraffe. We've got a few players that have earned that opportunity, Chris, to play throughout the season and training, showing up to training, putting in work, and a few of those guys for the Wichita Wings on the field. Amarillo traveled one roster on the way here, doesn't have the luxury of going back, but has not been in three games as the Wichita Wings now have. They're on two and Wichita on three, and it's really put Wichita in a difficult position physically, but also the recovery time that Amarillo had over Wichita after last night's game is significant.
Well, as we mentioned, you know, I mean, again, the league is here to serve the owners, and I think that when we have our meetings coming up, you know, during the summertime here, you guys want to tweak the playoff system, you know, look, it's your league. We just, you know, we answer to you guys.
Yeah, that's a great motto to have. And, you know, during owner meetings, the owners are able to get together and decide what's best. You know, you'd love to get to the point where you're following a program of a home and away playoff structure and best out of two in a mini game. And are these, you know, can the league get in a position to know what a goal? Let's come back to that and acknowledge this little half volley. Pure class from Rene Loya as he takes that off the hop and tucks it away, beats Aaron Parrott going to his right. Loya scoring, making it 3-1.
He had two or three goals yesterday. There were just outstanding shots. I mean, the one half volley he had yesterday against the Demon Hawks, outstanding goals.
Fantastic goal. Great player. Former Chihuahua Savage players, won a couple M2 championships already. He's no stranger to Wichita. Signed with the Amarillo this year with the Savage. Not returning to the MASL2, taking promotion, in fact. He was available. He came to Amarillo. The shot there blocked away from Max Shea.
We do have breaking news, Blake. I want to make everybody aware that Blake just ordered a cheeseburger here that looks really, really good.
It's wrapped in foil. It just smells good.
So I'm going to be going to the concession stand myself during our halftime break here. And
well, I'd like to acknowledge our esteemed intern, Bella Pusinelli, for heading to the concession stand for me and picking up that cheeseburger. But yeah, look, it was a long night. Right, got out of here late. It's not the ideal breakfast, if you will, based on the amount of sleep
I'm
on.
It's the breakfast of champions.
But it's something that's going to give me a little bit of energy because I'm going to be asked to come back and try to call this M2 final with a little bit of energy on behalf of the league. So
I'll be honest with you.
Taking it easy for now.
I have no dog in this fight, but, I mean, I didn't fall asleep probably until about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. I mean, I was just so wound up from those two great games yesterday. So, like I said, I can only imagine how you felt.
Well, if you want a description,
I'm
going to give you one. I'm going to give you one that's animated and not inappropriate.
Okay.
But to be honest, and this probably sounds over the top, I thought that there may have been like some kind of tremor or earthquake late when I finally laid down. My bed, I thought, shook. And I was like, what is that? And I stopped for a second and held my breath, and then it went. I was so worked up that when I was trying to wind down, my heartbeat was still so high. And and honestly said a prayer. Don't let this be the end, right? This can't be. I'm eating too many cheeseburgers and experiencing this crazy game that we love called indoor soccer. This can't be the end tonight. Well, and God's graces, I woke up today. But I honest to God, heartbeat was so, like, you could just feel it through the body that I actually thought my bed shook. And it took me a second to realize. And I realized that I had to calm my brain a little bit and wind down.
Much easier said than done, trust me. Been there, done that.
Another fantastic goal there from Kevin Albadrez. But these shots, Aaron Parrott's just looking at him as they go by. Two to his left, now two to his right. And that's 1-4. Albadrez gets on the score sheet as well. We're talking about the owners meeting before we saw Loya's goal and got carried away on cheeseburgers and heartbeats. There is a direct correlation with bad heartbeat and cheeseburgers, folks, so make sure you're aware of that. But the owners have the opportunity to make those decisions, and if you could ever get to a point where the games could end early enough in the regular season to where teams could plan logistically, financially pleasing travel. That's one of the great things about the MASL too, is the travel logistics usually allow to keep the economics in order. So you don't have teams that are just constantly in and out and leaving, and here comes a city with, you know, historically, you're gonna have an owner in an indoor city and they come in and then they realize, geez, this really isn't the model that I was looking for. In order, first of all, are they trying to make money as a business, or most of us want to put on a good product for our city and do something that's really about the city, about the people and community and these bigger relationships we've been talking about. But you also don't want to hemorrhage $500,000 a year in that process. And the M2 has found a model that fixes that and is sustainable. But maybe the next step is just finding a way to finish those games a little bit earlier, and then also allow for good time to plan the travel ahead to where you can have home and home type games. But that also means that there's going to be a long range of time between playoff games, and that doesn't work either. So, you know, I don't have the right answer for that. I know it's something that the owners can talk about, but because of that financial logistical concern and quick turnaround time, one time with FC Wichita, we were going to go in an Open Cup game, I believe it was. We won, and 4 days later we had to be in peak season in July. I forget what the event was, maybe it was an Open Cup, but it was a 4-day turnaround from Wichita to Myrtle Beach in their peak season.
Oh God.
And the only place the flights was $25,000 to get the whole team there. And the only place we could stay that had any space was the most expensive resort. So the guys loved it, right?
I'm sure they did.
Rented vans. The vans seen you coming from a mile away, so they gouged you.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a difficult thing. And look, when these teams are spending, owners want to get into a league that isn't going to cost them $40,000 on a 4-day turnaround, right? And that's ultimately what that was, and that was an outdoor league. And I haven't had that experience as an operator in the MASL2, and that's fantastic, right? But we have to find a way. As the league expands, I think there's enough expansion going on that you can have some cross-conference nearby, make those first couple playoff home-and-home games travel to where, you know, you're traveling to them by bus or by ground transportation. And if you want to fly, great, fly. But you don't want to mandate, you know, 6-7 road trips where you have to fly across the country.
No,
and that's what's great about the owners coming together, is they can sort through that.
Look, at when it's all said and done, it's a business. My philosophy has always been, you know what, the on-the-field product is important, but when it's all said and done, it's about, you know, income and expenses. It all starts and ends with the quality of the ownership groups. That's why I'm excited personally when you got, you know, people like Chad Hendricks in Minneapolis, you got Dr. Edo in Wisconsin, you got Matt and Kyle in Danbury, you got David Fresquez in Santa Fe. Smart, young, entrepreneurial, business-minded people. So as the league grows, and again, we're here to serve, we be in the league, whatever format, you want to add some more games, you want to change the playoff format, you know, but it's got to make sense financially.
And we're back here, not sure who's down, trying to get a peek at this again. As we're talking back and forth, we missed this. Foul happens in sport, but as you get later and later into this weekend and more games, becomes more potential. Looks like this is Alvarez. He's going to get pulled up here, fortunately, and walk off on his own recognizance. 5-1, Amarillo Bombers lead the Wichita Wings. Wichita reeling right now. Came out, scored, led 1-0, 1-2 for quite some time, and then Amarillo's really opened this up as Wichita starts to tire. Again, Wichita on game three, Amarillo on game two. Amarillo with significant recovery time last night. Wichita just down to the wire, losing in overtime. Takes a lot out of you. We'll see if the Wichita Wings can focus here and stay a little bit mentally strong and try to keep this game a little bit more respectable.
You know, I wanted to take a second here, and I'll do it. Well, I mean, I won't be on the championship broadcast, but Blake and Alejo from the Greenhawks will be on that broadcast. But I want to take a second just to thank, you know, some of our hardworking people that, you know, that helped Andrew and I over the course of the season. You know, Scott Ludwig, our social media, I think the best PR guy, by estimation, and Brian Ackley. You know, they do a fantastic job. Look, we're a small but unified group here. Certainly not done from a financial perspective, but more so because love of the sport. And I wanted to thank Scott and Brian for everything they've done all year long. They've done a fantastic job.
Yeah, one of those other guys instrumental in that group behind the scenes helping us put it all together, Graham Florence, referee coordinator, does a lot, answers a lot of questions. Of course, if there's a bad call, that call's coming to you, you know, it's coming to Graham. And it's not just a bad call on the field, but when people think that it's pivotal and changes the game, I can promise you, you didn't get any bad text messages from me last night. But or did you?
No. I mean, I didn't
find like footprints in the snow or anything.
No, I got some very poignant emails, but no, nothing from you, Blake. To your credit,
but from Wings fans,
yes.
Sending the emails. Okay.
Yeah.
Which, you know, were not the only one that got those emails.
Well, you know what? It's good. You know, I'd rather have that, to be honest with you, because that shows that people care.
Well, folks, you heard it from Chris here. If you're a Wings fan and you're upset, he is reading your emails, although he probably didn't reply.
Well,
if
no,
you want to pour it on, hey, look,
Blake, please,
have at it.
You know, I mean, I...
Do you want to say your email now, or would you like to give your cell phone number?
No.
Okay.
No. I mean, look it. You know, I've always been described as my biggest attribute is my passion, my biggest detriment is my passion. So I try and find balance there. But at any rate, you know, it's good, you know, that, you know, we want to be a better league. And I'm glad that you mentioned Graham. You know, you got three people in Graham and Scott and Brian that actually care. So, you know, are we perfect? No. Do we miss things? Absolutely. Well, we do the best that we can with what we have. And then my partner and I, Mr. Ross, you know, we try and handle most of the things, but special thanks to them because, they are in a thankless job.
I agree. And it takes a village to make all of this work, so we appreciate everybody. Rashad Amati to the left, Kevin Tenike on the ball, Lucio to the right. Ball goes to Lucio. Lucio's shot blocked away there. Jared Robbins and Taylor Henry also in the match. That ball looks like it did carry over and run into the Amarillo bench. 7 minutes left in the half. Wichita trailing by four. Peter Espinoza here near side on the ball. He puts that down the line to Henry. Henry, defender for the Wichita Wings, is having to take some shifts as a target man right now. Rashad Amati, what a weekend he's had. He had five last night in that semifinal game and three the night before. Ball laid off there, tried to find Amati from Henry and just short, dispossessed. Now the Bombers going the other way. Conrad Goldborn, Carrasco, he takes that touch around. Aaron Parrott off his line, big save from Parrott. Clearance, he's going to put that touch in the boards and out of bounds near side here. Some fans helping us out in the stands, getting to engage and throw the ball back into near side. Referee appears to be Brian Bauer. Good officiating crew. We don't always agree with the officials, and certainly they're not always correct, and
I'm
neither are
here.
Neither are the
Blake
players.
Blake is being very, very politically correct here.
But I will say this: when I say good officiating crew, I don't mean they're good referees by any way, shape, or form. You can make your own analysis on that. What I mean is it's a good group of guys. We have 13, 14 guys here. They're invested in the game. There's referees around the field judging each other, grading each other. There's two in the box. And then you have the two on the field. These are the guys that we've hoped have earned the right to be here and have done well throughout the season. And as you see, Juan Zamora coming up a little bit funny right there, sticking his foot in the turf and knee bending just a little bit on him. And that's a little bit of grimace there for Zamora as he heads over towards the wings bench. Not what you want to see.
His
foot definitely got stuck in the ground there a little bit, and his knee buckled, and those never turn out the way you want. I'm guessing Zamora's probably shut it down if a sprained knee or a little bit of turn or whatever it might be. Looks like he's in some pain over there.
You know, I'll be honest with you, Blake. I mean, for a Sunday afternoon, I know that this is, you know, a lot of church, you know, as if throughout the country, you know, not a bad turnout.
These are Wings season ticket holders that are coming to say thank you and goodbye to the team for the season. And that's fantastic. You get, you know, hundreds of people come out just to say, hey, we appreciate you. You've worked hard. These were tickets that were
final?
Part of their. I don't know what's going to happen for that. I haven't spoke to anybody directly. I do know there's a few people that are excited that want to watch good soccer. But these season tickets came with the playoff ticket. And then those that bought a playoff ticket for Friday, Saturday, and a all-session pass got Sunday free.
Great.
So there's some people that not necessarily just seeing the value, but it's an opportunity again. When you see the black and orange and white, or even some of the blue and yellow, because we use the old retro logo as well in a lot of the merchandise. You know, they're just good fans. We just have good fans here, and they know what the guys put in last night. We had a couple come up here in front of us in the broadcast booth earlier, and Andrew Ross was standing next to me, and they were, oh, I was so mad at the referee, but this and that, but God,
maybe
the guys.
Maybe it was the same lady that emailed me.
No. She was real. This was not the same lady that typed an email. She said, I'm just so proud of how hard the team fought and how meaningful it is to us. And, you know, I was excited. It was the highest intensity game of the year. And they were just talking about the experience and the environment and how they're so appreciative that the team is good enough to have the moments where we belong in those games. And you know, when you can point at one or two moments that you can point at somebody else, you can point at the referees, a mistake here or there, a missed opportunity, then those are usually good games.
Yeah. I mean, again, not to be redundant, but both games yesterday, and especially the Wings Rochester game, I mean, again, they're going to go down as probably, you know, especially your game. I mean, I'm not blowing smoke. Just being honest, I mean, that could be the game of the, obviously the game of the year so far, but the game of the ages.
Kevin Tenike on the ball, Amadi to the left. Amadi gets it shot just a little bit high. He's been able to wrap his foot around those all weekend and score. He just hits that one a little bit high.
No, I had the pleasure of talking to Mershad before the game a little bit, and what a nice young man. Again, quality. To be honest with you, I'm going to try and talk to him to see if he wants to play outdoor for my PDL team in Dothan, Alabama. But I obviously want to talk to you about that.
Yeah, we better have that conversation before we put it all over the broadcast. Thanks for coming here in support of the league, but let's not be starting to come here and recruit and put on wear your league hat.
I'm being facetious.
But I will say he's definitely good enough to be impactful at inside, outside, any level, and we certainly love to see that from Rashad.
My point was is that he's a very nice young man.
He is a very nice young man, and he is younger than you think. You look at him, and you see the mustache and beard, and you go, oh, well.
How old is he?
And you think this guy might be in his 30s, and he's actually in his mid to early 20s.
I've got shoes older than him. Come on.
You do. You definitely do. You're wearing them now, in fact.
Facts, Blake. All right, okay.
His old wingtips.
All right, well, you know. Mr. Fashion Critic here.
Hey, you can't see us right now in the booth, but I've put away my sport jacket for the weekend. I'm not in Allen Edmonds and $1,000 suits. I'm in a hoodie. Of course, it's Capelli, sponsored by Capelli here. in the MASL, so we appreciate their support.
I can assure you that this is not a $1,000 suit.
Well, I ran out of them. It's been 3 days with sport jackets, and I'm at the point now I'm just ready. If I can get a little bit of 5 hour energy in me and a nap.
You're doing great, Blake. You're doing fantastic. I'll be honest with you. I mean, I've gotten so many compliments. He goes, who's doing the broadcast? The guy's really, really good. I go, it's Blake.
Goal, second post there. David Trevizio. 6-1, Amarillo, 3 minutes left in the half. A delayed 2 minute penalty was offered to Matt Sherritt for a handball as he's diving, hitting that ball out of the way.
I think I'm gonna get Junior.
They're
here.
Come over and report this, I believe, here on the near side. The referees are coming over. I believe this was a delayed penalty that is not gonna be a penalty because they gave advantage and scored. So let's see if they give this to 77, Matt Sherritt here. We're waiting for the official communication from the PA. Oh, this is, yeah, they almost got this wrong. And as I'm saying, hey, these referees are all right, these calls, they actually called a delayed 2 minute penalty, allowed advantage, let them score the goal, then took the player that they gave the advantage on the 2 minute and put him in the sin bin. They figured it out though. It took four of them, but they got it sorted. I didn't have to yell from above, and I don't have a buzzer or anything. It's a shocker. So they figured it out. And that's why we have so many referees down there around the field, is sometimes we have to take a step back and make sure we communicate and get that right. Well done by the officials.
Again, I'll put my hockey hat on here. Same thing happens in hockey. If there's a delayed penalty and you score on it, then there's obviously no penalty.
That is correct. Many of the rules in indoor soccer have origins of hockey. And of course, we're playing on a 200 long by 80 foot wide pitch that's a hockey rink, ultimately, with turf over it. And here at Hartman Arena, we do not have ice underneath. But when they built this, they built it for events, but with soccer in mind. So I don't know how many arenas there are, Chris, in the United States where there's indoor soccer teams playing right now that they weren't hockey rinks before they were soccer rinks. That's something that a lot of people probably don't know about Hartman Arena. When the Wings stopped playing in 2011, 12, and then 13, 14, there was a stint with the Wichita B-52s before it went defunct. The team had football and soccer, and we would switch over the turf. Well, the soccer turf was what was easiest to sell in 2014, 15, whatever it was. So the soccer turf sold quickly, kept the football turf, then bring back the soccer team for the Wichita Wings in 2019 during that rebirth after a few years. So that's why we end up with this wild turf, looking to get new turf. But there's no hockey underneath it. There is a Wichita Regulators indoor football team that's new as of last year. They start playing tomorrow, so they'll be able to save a little bit of time on that transition tonight, because once we're done, it'll be take down the plexiglass, bring in the pads, and it'll transition to arena football.
So there is no Wichita Wild in Wichita Arena?
There is not. There was. It's now the Regulators. The only thing wild right now is this turf.
Okay.
But we did miss a heck of an opportunity, not because we haven't asked yet, but you could just put Wings underneath that Wild, and Buffalo Wild Wings be your main sponsor. We had something.
There you go.
I will say that's crossed my mind quite a few times. In fact, every time I step foot in here.
Well, it would be a natural.
Somebody let the CEO of Buffalo Wild Wings know that for me, please. Well, I appreciate you saying that I've done a good job. This is obviously a much more relaxed broadcast than what we've had due to the situation.
No, I mean, but again, I've had a lot of people, a lot of the owners text me, who's doing the broadcast? He's great. They've had a couple of comments about myself, but I'm trying to do my best. That's why you got, the talent, and then you got,
Well, I praise. Would not consider myself a broadcast talent. In fact, I was not the broadcast guy on Tuesday until we had somebody come down sick and couldn't make it happen for Wednesday. So I said, stay home, I'll handle it this weekend.
You got numbers here for the Wings. Oh, nice shot. Nice shot.
Good goal for Peter Espinoza. 3v2 going the other way. Kevin Ten Eyck overlapping. Taylor Henry on the ball, and he finds Peter Espinoza. And let me say, a unique story on Peter Espinoza. He deserves that moment and proud of him. Peter Espinoza hasn't played in a lot of games this year for the Wichita Wings. In fact, over the last few years, had a few surgeries, grew up in Wichita. Roy Turner's son was Peter Espinoza's best friend growing up. So Peter Espinoza, as you're looking at there, he grew up a Wichita Wings fan, loves the game, played at Fringe University, has dealt with some injuries, great media guy. He's actually one of the voices of the Wichita Wings and does a lot of our broadcasts. Loves to be around the team, but he trains, he earns the opportunity, and with the injuries, Peter gets to dress, and he comes out and gets to score a goal for his childhood team.
You know what, and that's great. You know, you work hard all year long, you know, you do your part. It's nice to see the guys get a chance to be recognized, so it's, if nothing else.
Great finish from Peter, bravo. Look, this isn't just a bone we're throwing Peter. He's a very good player. He's played at a high level. He's played indoor soccer for some time now. He's as you get older and you've had a few surgeries, he's lost a step. That was a big moment for Peter to prove to himself that he's still got it in the tank a little bit. So congrats Peter and your entire family. I'm sure is proud of you for that. We will be back. This is halftime. We got 15 minutes before we go back after this break. Johnny Freedom is going to get an interview here with Amarillo, and then we're going to go to a break, and we'll be back for the second half. We're going to have Juan Carrasco, number 96, and he's got a goal tonight to boot. Johnny Freedom down there with Juan Carrasco and J.B. Parker, owner, CEO of the Amarillo Bombers.
Hey, MASL fans, watching this third place consolation game, Johnny Freedom here with Juan Carrasco. Juan, congratulations. I think you got a goal here today, right?
Yes, I have. I did get a goal today.
Well, congratulations. I know it's a bummer playing in the consolation match here, but trying to have a little bit of fun in this last game. You guys are doing well, 6-2 heading into the Wichita Wings. What was the thought process coming into this third place game?
Was a sort of a new player. It's very nerve-wracking because you have to come into an environment that's very intense. And in the back of your mind, soccer player, you always don't want to mess up. So for me, it was just thinking my mom would always tell me before a game is to relax. Take a deep breath and just have fun, because it's all, at the end of the day, it's all it's all about. Just have fun and play your soccer.
Absolutely. No wiser words than to have fun while playing soccer, right? Well, congratulations on the 6-2 victory. Go get yourself something to drink, get a little break, and we'll see you in about 15 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, from the Amarillo Bombers, Juan Carrasco.
Gimme, Bill Graves.
IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes with our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more. There's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
Bring in your old lease to the new Vision. During our great lease buyback, we'll get you out of your lease and into the brand new Vision vehicle of your dreams. No matter how many months or years you have left, no matter where you bought it from, no matter how many miles over you are. Well, I have instructed the Vision stores to look past all of that. This is the time, the great lease buyback from Vision.
Follow your heart to Vision with 10 locations across Western New York.
If your bank ain't Texas family owned, then it ain't for you, old son. If your bank doesn't walk your grandmother to her car, if you don't hear a Texas accent when you call,
if your bank doesn't deliver awesome customer service
more than it delivers BS, then it ain't for nobody, old son. Sounds like you need to bank with Amarillo National.
And cut.
Whew, that felt good. Be careful, I might take your job.
At IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes with our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more. There's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order. IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes with our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more. There's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
We're live at the Rochester's Choice Awards. It's the final lap in the 200-meter swimming event, and Bill Gray's takes it by a long shot. Earlier in track and field, the Bill Gray's hot dog dominated in the high jump, the long jump, the pole vault, and of course, the 200-meter sprint. And we go now to boxing. Bill Gray's does it again. Bill Gray's is Rochester's choice for the best fish fry, the best hot dog, and of course, the world's greatest cheeseburger.
Bring in your old lease to the new Vision. During our Great Lease Buyback, we'll get you out of your lease and into the brand new Vision vehicle of your dreams. No matter how many months or years you have left, no matter where you bought it from, no matter how many miles over you are, well, I have instructed the Vision stores to look past all of that. This is the time, the Great Lease Buyback from Vision.
Follow your heart to Vision with 10 locations across Western New York.
If your bank ain't Texas family owned, then it ain't for you, old son. If your bank doesn't walk your grandmother to her car, if you don't hear a Texas accent when you call,
if your bank doesn't deliver awesome customer service
more than it delivers BS, then it ain't for nobody, old son. Sounds like you need to bank with Amarillo National.
And cut.
Whew, that felt good. Be careful, I might take your job.
At IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes. With our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more, there's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order. IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes. With our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more, there's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
Hey, Wichita Wings fans, you know this is our last game of the 2024 season. So the guys and Roger just had a couple quick words to say to everyone, and thanks for all your support.
Yeah, like Johnny said, we appreciate you. Appreciate you guys coming out. Obviously, we're a little, our legs are a little hungover today, but it means a lot to us that you guys come out and support us on Sunday, especially after being here last night. So thank you guys for tonight. Thank you guys for the whole season. We thoroughly appreciate you guys. The reason we play is for you guys. So okay, thank you guys for still out here.
The best fans in indoor soccer, right here in Wichita, Kansas, our Orange Army. We appreciate you guys so much. You know, it's hard for us to be out here after a tough game against Rochester. But we thank you guys. Always can count on our Orange Army right here in Wichita, Kansas. Thank you so much.
At IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes. With our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more, there's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
If your bank ain't Texas family owned, then it ain't for you, old son. If your bank doesn't walk your grandmother to her car, if you don't hear a Texas accent when you call,
if your bank doesn't deliver awesome customer service
more than it delivers BS, then it ain't for nobody, old son. Sounds like you need to bank with Amarillo National.
And cut.
Whew, that felt good. Be careful, I might take your job.
Just a little higher.
goal from Rashad Amadi on the Wichita power play, assisted by Kevin Tenaik. Lead cut by another goal, 6-3 Amarillo in this third place MASL 2 playoff game. And please, folks watching at home, a good save from Parrott. Accept my apologies on the audio for the first 3 minutes of this half. We were graced with the presence of indoor soccer legend and Rochester Lancers owner, Soccer Sam. So I had a few minutes to speak with Sam and wanted to show him around the arena for a few minutes here. We're short-staffed for this first game so that we can staff the final appropriately for the number one seeded Iowa Demon Hawks, unbeaten on the year, facing the number two Rochester Lancers, also unbeaten on the year. Came out ahead of the curve last night with 2 minutes left in overtime, beating these Wichita Wings and heading to the national final at 4 p.m. Foul on Alvarez, that's Taylor Henry, recycles through Kevin Tenaik. Philip Wynn, number 17 for the Wichita Wings. He plays that ball across. Kevin Tenaik back to Phil. Good ball into Henry. Dispossessed by Goldborn. Picked up by David Treviso. Carrasco. Alan Valenzuela. Allowing Sam Webb and Carrasco to switch deep in the Wichita defensive third. Overlapping is Machado. Valenzuela swings near side. Sal Calderon. Max Shea out to pressure. Now Taylor Henry. Wichita looking to pick up a little bit higher pressure and change the tempo. Kevin Tenaik near side against Sam Webb. Ball hit over the top. Parrott might have to deal with that. Carrasco. Defended by Wynn, goes to the ground. Referee says nothing in it. Amarillo doing a good job to keep possession. Wichita sitting in, trying to save those legs. Wichita again, six players from last night's roster, the semifinal, not playing here. Couple injuries, an additional injury today to Juan Zamora to add insult to that. But Kaiki Trevilato, Juan Zamora, Kieran Lake, and Carlos Vidrio. Kaiki Trevilato, Junior Quezada among the players, if I didn't mention Lalo Giraffe, meant to mention him as well, that will not be playing in this match. Aaron Parrott in goal. Jose Ocampo, the Wings backup keeper, also over there and available should the Wings need an extra body on the field. Wings goal scorers to get to three. Peter Espinoza, Taylor Henry, and Rashad Amadi. Henry on two assists as well. Wichita trying to stay in this game long enough to be able to attack with a little bit more legs in the fourth quarter, but just a tired team after a late game last night. Players not getting home until 10, 11 o'clock at night. Starting a recovery right after the match right here at the arena. Having to turn around and go for a 1 p.m. Central kickoff on their third game of the weekend against Amarillo's second. Dantes and Carrasco get tripped up, and Dantes says, my bad, but don't dive here. It's already a 6-3 game. Referees issue a delay of game warning to the Amarillo bench for not distributing the ball back quickly for Wichita's restart. Tenaik plays Parrott. Parrott into Amadi, just misses that pass, forces Amadi to have to defend against Benji Monreal. Monreal hit him behind, that's Loya. Loya and Parrott. Loya trying to dispossess Parrott, and he does, but Parrott kind of flicks it away. Parrott just got the ball caught under him. Monreal now in front of goal. Parrott picks it up. Good defense from Rashad Amadi to usher Benji Monreal away. Line change, Tenaik out, Zach in. This one intercepted by Jorge Miller. Miller back to Chavez. Fredo Chavez has a little space to carry it up. He's looking deep into the corner. He's played a ball over the top and found Saul Calderon on the run. David Lucio dispossesses Calderon. Dangerous but effective tackle and wins the ball. As a result, Lucio gets tangled up, comes back and fouls Calderon. Sorry, Kevin Alvarez, who had left both feet to commit into that challenge and didn't seem to get Lucio, but Lucio opted out when he left his feet. Luis Dantas from Lisbon, Portugal, steps forward. Left side of him, Mershad Ahmadi, Afghanistan. This side, Benji Monreal being a little bit shut down by Taylor Henry at this moment. Benji and Taylor pushed each other, laughing, former teammates, but definitely want to be competitive. Benji, header into Loya, sack defending, now Henry. Henry against Benji. Benji's won that battle. Taylor Henry comes back, fights through, and he's still going. Henry, Loya, takes an elbow from Rene Loya up high, and they call this foul on Taylor Henry. Not sure if they pointed the right direction, but it appears to be a blue card against Rene Loya for an elbow as he throws his arm back and makes contact above the head to Taylor Henry. They're trying to figure it out down here on the field, but Henry and Loya going back and forth. Henry gets pretty physical with Loya, but not fouling him from behind. Little bit of grabbing, and Loya, not an elbow, but a hand, brings his hand back, puts it up around behind his back, and does try to make contact with the face of Taylor Henry. Does so, and that's going to be a penalty. This is on day two because they have video imagery and photography of Loya being engaged in the fight last night. The referees were talking about it. They're not going to let him make contact. Had a shot to the back of the head of Iowa Demon Hawks' Thiago Freitas during a scrum that sent off a few Amarillo players and a red card specifically to the backup goalkeeper for Amarillo yesterday. And in the middle of that was Rene Loya, so they definitely were on it today. And he's trying to explain his cause, but they're saying yes, but we've already had too much contact above the head, and we're going to protect these players. We'll stay right here. We're not going to take a break because it was just a brief timeout. 7 minutes, 4 seconds left in the third quarter. Wichita on a 2-minute power play here. Kevin Tenai, Jared Robbins, David Lucio, Mershad Ahmadi, and Taylor Henry. The first foul was against Taylor Henry. The second action from Loya gets Loya a 2-minute penalty. So Wichita will not have the ball here, but they will be on a power play once they collect the ball. The penalty kill unit, who's currently in possession of the ball, is the Amarillo Bombers. Jorge Miller, Benji Monreal, Alan Valenzuela. And Jorge Gonzalez, the fourth player. Wichita pressing, trying to win the ball back so they can start their man advantage. Turn quickly there, that's Jorge. Gonzalez to Monreal. Back over to Gonzalez, and he was lining up, looking for something special. Wichita needs to calm down, allow Amarillo to drop into their set, and Wichita can have the 5-on-4 advantage. Ball played down the line to Henry. Henry turning, finds Mershad Ahmadi. Ahmadi to Tenai. Ahmadi to Tenai's left. Lucio to his right. Jared Robbins in the middle, and Taylor Henry hiding by the second post. Benji Monreal chipped over the top there, trying to find Jorge Gonzalez on a counterattack as Valenzuela, Gonzalez, and Monreal are still trying to create chances off their defense. Up 6-3, 1 minute, 15 seconds left in this Wichita power play. Wichita very sluggish after that late match last night, about 5 hour more recovery time for the Amarillo Bombers in Wichita this week on one more additional game than the Bombers. See it in the legs. Wichita willing themselves to stay in this match. Down by a handful, they pulled it back to 6-3. And a great opportunity now with only 50 seconds left, though, to create a couple chances to score and see if they can cut the lead to two. Miller to the ground, but Robbins stays strong. Shot, Mershad Ahmadi, sends that up into the section 110. It's going to be in the hands of Fredo Chavez. He'll have an opportunity to throw this ball back deep into the end for the Wichita Wings and kill more time off of it. Benji Monreal, Jorge Gonzalez, both pushing forward to see if they can win it. Kill some of that time. Monreal is going to go on a mission against Kevin Tenike. Pressing Tenike, Parrott lays it off to Henry. 30 seconds left in the Wichita power play. Tenike, Henry, back to Tenike, back to Henry. Henry, maybe an opportunity to have a go. Plays inside to Robbins. Robbins back to Henry. 7 seconds left. Five, last chance Wichita. Cleared away. They're out and running. There goes Jorge Miller. He gets a through ball. Taylor Henry's going to have to track him down. Miller onto the ball, shielding as Henry's defending him. Miller finds Loya as the penalty expires. Loya back in. He's dispossessed. And he's asking for his teammate to talk to him so he knows that he doesn't have the time. Doesn't get that communication from the defenders. Amarillo kills the penalty, but turns the ball right back over. 4 minutes, 40 seconds left in the third quarter. Phillip Wynn to Sherrod. Matt Sherrod to Amadi. Amadi down the line to Sherrod. Sherrod need his legs today. First minutes of the weekend are coming today for Matt Sherrod and Phillip Wynn. Loya sees Valenzuela running, but that just drops off the Wichita defense in time to find Alvarez. Now Alan Valenzuela. Kevin Alvarez. Patient as you like from Amarillo. Just trying to get their sets, but controlling the tempo of this game. Up 3 goals already against the Wichita Wings. Good work from Luis Dantes, but he's dispossessed and that ball's recycled. Here comes the fresh legs of Peter Espinoza, and he's out running, trying to speed up Valenzuela. Valenzuela finds Felipe Baez. Baez near side to David Treviso. Pushed a little bit by Luis Dantes. That's a foul against Dantes for the Wichita Wings. Referee Brian Bauer all over that, right in front of him. David Alves. Treviso, excuse me. Dantes. Pushed down by Treviso. Dantes didn't like the extra effort there from David Treviso. Treviso pays no attention and we move on. Daniel Sack on the ball. He plays into Lucio. Lucio to Espinoza. Peter Espinoza side to side with Daniel Sack. Slow roller from Sack and Parrott doesn't come to get it. Just lets the ball glide to him in Wichita. Fortunate to be unscathed there. Good save from Chavez. Ball laid across from Espinoza to Jared Robbins, and Robbins tries to go across goal, just missed because the outstretched arm of Fredo Chavez. Treviso cutting, looking to take on Sack, lays that ball back. We've got a foul there against Max Shea of the Wichita Wings. Just grabbed Machado. And hold this up for a player to tie his shoe here. 2 minutes, 50 seconds left in the third quarter. Amarillo Bombers coming into this weekend, the number 5 seed, lead the number 3 seed, Wichita Wings. Both teams lost highly emotional games yesterday. So a bit of a somber affair, frankly, here in the third place game. Probably not the most intensity from both teams. Still with a very professional approach. Appreciative to be here and trying to play attractive soccer. Just not that same intensity level that we had yesterday or that we expect to have in the final coming up at 4 p.m. Central Time. The M2 final. You'll want to stick around with us right here if you're watching. There's Taylor Henry down low, defended by Machado. Henry just leaves and forgets the ball, but he's won it back. Plays Lucio. Lucio dispossessed there by Carrasco. Out and running is Goldborn. He's fighting with Max Shea. He's got position, second post. Carrasco turning, cutting. Turns Kevin Tenike. Shot, Goldborn, second post, and Max Shea went over to help and just left Conrad Goldborn wide open. Goldborn gets a sitter on the second post. That's 7-3 now, unassisted from Conrad Goldborn. Colin Lauders won that near side, plays that back across to Taylor Henry. Quickly, the Wichita Lynx capitalized and cut that lead again back to 3 goals. Great effort from the Eagle, Colin Lauder, putting in work down the line there, throws this ball across to Taylor Henry. Good ball from Lauder, great position from Henry to pop out, not run to the second post, but come in front of Valenzuela. Taylor Henry's had quite the weekend as well.
The assist being credited to the Eagles, Colin Lauder.
Chavez on the ball near side. Bombers lead 7-4 over the Wichita Lynx. Hit into Paris. Last year's MASL2 goalkeeper of the year, Aaron Parrott. Leading the Wings from the back today. 1 minute left in the third quarter. Lauder versus Webb. Sam Calderon tracks Lauder after Lauder lays that ball off and makes a run forward. Jared Robbins, the target. Robbins to sack, sack to Lauder. Lauder, Robbins. Great goal from the Wichita Wings. Good bit of play between sack, Lauder, and Robbins. And Lauder gives us that target player. Lauder the target, Robbins running off. You don't hear that too often, but a good goal from Robbins. Good football from Colin Lauder. 2 assists in less than 2 minutes from the Eagle, Colin Lauder. Wichita back in this game, trailing 7-5, 1 minute left in the third quarter. Guys having a little bit of fun, laughing that Jared is the one overlapping over there, certainly. Jared says, I'm the one on the run. I'm supposed to be holding the ball. Colin puts his hands up and says, yeah, he's not going to do it. I'll go post up down there. Whatever it was, it's working. Amadi to Henry. Henry, header to Henry. Henry cushion header, tries to play back to Amadi. This ball hit in behind from Tenite to David Lucio. It's going to stay in bounds. Lucio flicked on Amadi. Amadi just misses that touch, but good defense from David Trevizio. Jorge Miller tries to clear, and he plays Philip Wynn. Wynn to Lucio. Lucio's going to recycle to Tenike, and Tenike on a ton of minutes this weekend. Yesterday, early in that third quarter, defensive line mate Kieran Lakin takes a red card, puts the Wings in a situation to rotate. Henry, Tenike, and Sack. Then Henry gets a yellow and puts him in the sin bin for over 5 minutes of that action. A ton of work had to be done by Sack and Kevin Tenike. Matt's gonna.
How about that third quarter, Wings fans? Yes! We're heading to the fourth quarter. Amarillo Bombers in the Wichita Wings 7-5. The Pest Professionals have Buffalo's Pest Control providing professional pest control services for home and business owners throughout Wichita, Kansas. Find them online at buffalo.com. More people every time Alpha Lit Wichita.
Give me just any old cheeseburger. Only Bill Gray's will do.
Yeah.
I love the taste and the quality and the juicy through and through.
It's the world's greatest cheeseburger. Made fresh for you each day.
When you're looking for something good cooking, say give me Bill Gray's.
A delicious meal with family or friends is a great way to share the day.
If you're getting hungry, say give me Bill Gray's.
Welcome back into Hartman Arena in Park City, Kansas, home of the Wichita Wings, host of the MASL2 2024 playoffs. We've had quarters, we've had semifinals. Now this game, the third place game, followed by a 4 p.m. Central Time match between the Iowa Demon Hawks and the Rochester Lancers, two unbeaten teams on the season, obviously haven't faced off against each other, and they will play for the M2 championship at 4 p.m. Wichita, meantime, has trailed for most of this game. They led 1-0, was their only lead, been down 5-6 goals, and they've clawed back in true Wings fashion, missing numerous players in this roster right now, but trying to be competitive and staying with it. There's Renee Loya. Another goal for Loya. He scored a few tonight. Makes that 8-5 once again. Good save after that deflection. Parrott stays with it and is able to push it away. Wichita trailing 8-5, 14 minutes left in the last game of the season for both of these teams. Taylor Henry taking on Valenzuela, pushes it by. Henry determined against Chavez. Chavez clears. Lauder comes up to collect. Lauder side to side to Philip Wynn. Henry down the line. He's going to catch this ball from Wynn. Turn and see if he can face Valenzuela. Wynn on the ball still. Dispossessed, pushed off just a little bit by Trevizio. They continue to fight about it, and Wynn gets it. Lauder now. Lauder to Dantas. Dantas, 1v1, looking for his shot. Decides to play side to side with Wynn. Touchback from Wynn to Robbins. Robbins to Wynn. Back to Dantas. Wichita probing, looking for a good opportunity. Can have two players change. Rashad Amadi in, Peter Espinoza in. Amadi runs off. There's a tackle from behind from Dantas. On Dantas against Kevin Alvarez. But appears. Amarillo not happy about it. Says they got the ball. Kevin Tenney asking more than likely why, if that's a foul, why it's not a two-minute penalty or even a shootout as he's in behind and it takes away a goal-scoring opportunity. The tackle, the only Fredo Chavez left between the goal and the ball, the tackle came from the side or behind, is the Wings point. Nevertheless, not a two-minute penalty. Kevin Tenney on this set piece. Tenney decides to take a timeout, realizes that with 13 minutes and 15 seconds left in this match, this is a big opportunity and the Wings need to get a look out of it. We're going to take a quick break and be right back with you in a moment.
At IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes with our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more. There's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
Welcome back to Hartman Arena in Park City, Kansas. Wichita Wings down 8-5 in this third place M2 playoffs match, trailing their interconference foe, the Amarillo Bombers. Wichita Wings, 2 wins against 1 loss in the regular season to the Bombers, and Bombers looking to make it 500 here and even up the score. Wichita on a very short recovery from last night's game. Emotional loss in overtime. That's Rashad Amati, Kevin Tenite, David Lucio, flicked onto Henry. Henry's shot, that's blocked away by Machado. Now Henry, or I'm sorry, Kevin Tenite is gonna have to play that ball in the air, which he does, back to Parrott. Well played from Tenite. David Lucio down the line to Taylor Henry. Henry battling just a little bit there. A foul goes against Alvarez. Now Goldborn joins him on the wall, so Kevin Tenite doesn't get a straight shot. Rashad Amati next to Tenite. Just play the simple ball to Amati. Amati shot. That thing's tucked in. Upper corner, and what a banger from Rashad Amati. And he's not done yet this weekend, folks. And he can find that top corner. Had a great goal last night. Had 5 of them, but a goal where he tucked one in the upper corner against Jacob Mitchell of the Lancers. And let's watch this. Gets his foot all the way around that ball, and Chavez, nothing he can do. Tenite says, or I'm sorry, Taylor Henry on the second post says, I don't need to touch it. Opts out and allowing Rashad Amati to have looks like that. That only results in one thing usually. Another goal for Rashad Amati. Two-goal lead for the Amarillo Bombers now. Amati pressing Carrasco on the near side, fouls him. Henry, Miller, Goldborn. Henry pushes it away. Amarillo back on the ball. That's number 23, Machado. Goldborn, Carrasco. Amarillo slowing it down. 12 minutes left in this match, trying to keep the lead. You can easily say meaningless game because it's not for a title, but anytime it's an interconference game, there's always bragging rights on the line. So Amarillo really fighting through, trying to come out, finish this weekend 1-1. Wichita Wings winning big on day one over Orlando, then playing on day two. The Lancers losing in overtime in this third game, taking a lot out of the guys. 9-6 right now, Amarillo Bombers lead the Wings after another goal from Conrad Goldberg. Robbins to Sack. Sack, he's finding Colin Lauder. Dantas to Lauder. There's Philip Wynn. He's going to have a go. He tries to shape that across goal in similar fashion to Rashad Amati. Just a little bit high, but a good opportunity and great idea from Philip Wynn. Wings trail by 3, 12 minutes left in this match. Dantas out pressuring. Ball in behind to Benji Monreal. Off the boards, that's collected by Lauder. Well read. Benji goes to the ground, wins a tackle over Lauder. Now Benji 3v2. A little bit of skill from Monreal there, and then Colin comes back and wins it after a clearance from Wynn. Wynn applying pressure to Sam Calderon. Now Jorge Miller, Monreal. Pushed out of bounds by Philip Wynn, apparently trying to flick it forward over the top of the Amarillo defense and just mishits that ball.
Wings fans, feel free to be singing this one. It's Journey.
Espinoza, Peter Espinoza, another assist from Henry, and Peter Espinoza with another great goal. His second goal, Pete Espinoza, my broadcast partner half the time for the Wichita Wings. Been recovering from injuries for years. And he comes down, he's finally healthy. We needed him today, and he comes out for his hometown team, and that's his second goal. Brace for Espinoza, 9-7. And the guy's happy for Peter. Fredo Chavez pressured by Jared Robbins. Valenzuela, Lucio on his back. Over to Trevizio. Robbins steps out, the Wings extending their pressure a little bit higher. Back to a two-goal game. Robbins fouls Trevizio as he's pushed it by. Pro foul from Robbins. Not a two-minute penalty that stopped Trevizio, who was 10 yards past Robbins if Robbins lets him go. Kevin Tenai, Peter Espinoza, Mershad Amadi, Jared Robbins and David Lucio on the pitch for the Wichita Wings. Challenge from Mershad Amadi, they call obstruction. Down goes Jorge Gonzalez. Good save from Parrott. Gonzalez dispossessed by Tenai. Tenai's going to keep a hold of this one and play the other way. Henry on the ball, looking to shoot, finds a second post. Mershad didn't think the ball was coming, but great ball across from Henry, who's already on multiple assists this evening. Two goals, two assists for Taylor Henry. Taylor Henry stumbles against Loya, gets feet caught up. They both go down, takes an opportunity away from Loya. Same thing the other way, it appeared, but Loya sticking his foot in just a little bit. Dantes contact with Loya's stomach, and Loya, down goes Loya. Let's see this again on instant replay. Okay, was a foul. Loya sticks his foot between Dantes. Dantes has words for him. Dantes does touch him. Loya down, shots fired. Probably Oscars for both, because I've seen Luis Dantes certainly embellish things over this year, but Rene Loya, definitely not enough contact from Luis Dantes to send Loya to the ground right there. Loya, big guy, he's saying, got me in the stomach, and this is Loya, yellow card. Now, this may be his third card. I think Loya's ejected. He had two-minute penalties and now a yellow card. I believe this is a combination. It is a red card for Loya. He's on his third card of the night. And it's just card accumulation. So Loya headed to the locker rooms. That red card's going to be a two-minute penalty against the Amarillo Bombers. Anytime you eject a player, and we saw that last night, it puts the team down. Even if it's a yellow card dissent, we had a red card to Kieran Laking last night in the semifinal, and that put Wichita on back-to-back penalty kill situations against the Lancers. It really opened the lead up for Rochester. In this situation, Wichita's behind by two. Red card to Rene Loy on card accumulation. It's a two-minute penalty, so power play situation for the Wings. Rashad Ahmadi on the left, Jared Robbins, Kevin Tenite, Taylor Henry, and David Lucio. And as I look at this power play, I realize, and I apologize to my friend and Wichita Wings player, Gui Oliveira. I knew we were missing more players. I hadn't said it so far today, but Guillerme Oliveira straining his hamstring in last night's match. He also number 10 for the Wichita Wings, and power play artist is not in this match right now. David Lucio on that side, however. Taylor Henry and Kevin Tenite at the top. Rashad Ahmadi to the left. Jared Robbins, target player in the paint. Juan Zamora still hasn't returned after a knee injury in the first half. Good ball in behind. This is Treviso. Treviso rolls Parrott, and the Amarillo Bombers have scored shorthanded to open up this lead 10-7. Wichita will still have a power play at 1:45 just to try to get it back to two goals with 9.5 minutes left in this match. Good bit of skill from Treviso. That's a hat trick for David Treviso. Third of the night. Good little find. This ball unfortunately goes in front of Henry, left to defend on his own. And Aaron Parrott out on the island has to come commit. Easy as you like for David Treviso. Tenite side to side with Lucio. Lucio to Henry. Henry puts that across to Robbins, but saved by Chavez. Chavez guns up throwing. Amarillo, nothing to lose here. Out and running on power play situations. Tenite comes over, gets into a challenge with Jorge Gonzalez. Tenite puts the ball out of bounds. It's going to be Amarillo ball near side. Treviso, shot, puts it across goal. Nobody really in the offensive half as they're still down a player and just looking to play off the counterattack. 1 minute, 15 seconds left in the Wichita power play. Just under 9 minutes left in the game. Wichita trails 10-7. Robbins to Tenite. Tenite, David Lucio. Lucio, Robbins, Henry. Lucio again, finds Kevin Tenite. Back to Lucio. Tenite to Rashad Ahmadi near side. What a tournament from Rashad Ahmadi. Great season and great showing in this tournament. Rashad Ahmadi, 2 years deal with the Wichita Wings. So as long as he wants to play indoor soccer, he'll be back next year. Wichita now on a penalty kill. And this is a lot of penalty kill minutes for Taylor Henry, Kevin Tenike, and Daniel Sack. Killed and got scored on, but we're in the position of a penalty kill unit last night multiple times in back-to-back succession at one point. Here they are again. Wichita trying to get out of this with a three-goal lead. Valenzuela hits that across goal. David Treviso, less than a minute left. 49 seconds. Kevin Tenight clears that away. 40 seconds left in the Amarillo power play. No Rene Loya, card accumulation red card. Wichita goes on a power play but doesn't score. In fact, gives up a shorthanded goal. Now Benji Monreal orchestrating the power play for the Bombers. That ball hit high and out of bounds. 26 seconds left on the Amarillo power play. 6 minutes, 25 seconds left in the match. Both teams' last game of the season. Wichita fans, I won't give you too much information, but I hear there might be some things going on in June here at Hartman Arena where the Wichita Wings are potentially hosting and putting something together, so stay tuned for that. Maybe their last game of this season, but maybe not last games of the year. Of course, next year starts in usually September type of time frame for tryouts, and the Wings start training, playing October, and then you can see games as early as November. So although this is the last game of the season, it's certainly not the last game of the calendar year. Stay tuned to social media for that. We'll be back with you in 60 seconds.
Bring in your old lease to the new Vision. During our great lease buyback, we'll get you out of your lease and into the brand new Vision vehicle of your dreams. No matter how many months or years you have left, no matter where you bought it from, no matter how many miles over you are, well, I have instructed the Vision stores to look past all of that. This is the time, the great lease buyback from Vision.
Follow your heart to Vision with 10 locations across Western New York.
Well, the soothing sound of Johnny Freedom's voice there, folks, as he sings on the PA for you. So Wings don't have the typical crowd tonight or this afternoon, early afternoon for this consolation game. I gotta say, I've had to hear him sing all year long, and his voice is getting just a little bit better every time out. So congratulations to Johnny. My voice, on the other hand, folks, I have to apologize. It's getting worse and worse every time out on this broadcast as we approach 10 games at 4 p.m. hosted here at Hartman Arena in Park City. Thank you to Park City, Kansas and Hartman Arena for putting this event on. We thank the hotels, the locals, the restaurants, and of course, the city itself for supporting us and allowing us to put on such a great event in partnership with the MASL too. Monreal flicks that into Goldborn, dispossessed. Wichita does kill that penalty. Now trying to find a way to claw back in. Peter Espinoza defending Luis Dantes, wins that ball, but dispossessed by Alvarez. Kevin Alvarez looking for a shot. He's defended here by Espinoza. That was just long enough for Henry to poke it away, but it goes straight to Goldborn. Goldborn lays it off to Benji. Benji off the boards, looking to find a runner. Wichita really struggling for legs. It shows in just about everybody, including Henry, but Henry's still flying around. He presses Chavez. Chavez to Dantes. Dantes now is going to have to play hard against Miller along the board. He does so. Miller goes to the ground, and we're going to have to see that one again. A pretty dangerous challenge. Sack mad at Jorge Miller for going in deep, and Jorge Miller got some words for Daniel Sack. Let's see this replay. Miller clawing and fighting and goes in and kicks Dantes right across the top of his knee. A couple dangerous fouls yesterday that incited that fight between the Iowa Demon Hawks and Amarillo. A couple of those were Jorge Miller, and this is him once again just mad because Dantes is playing hard, takes a swipe from behind him with the arm and then goes to the ground kicking, sliding, and kicks Dantes in the knee. And really, third place game. We don't need to come out of any game with injuries, but that's just unnecessary. Be good for Jorge Gonzalez to just sit down and cool off for a bit. careless fouls, we have to worry about player protection. Guys coming in from behind, we saw it multiple times. We've seen it last night with an errant player into knee into a back of Rashad Amadi, turning his hips, putting Amadi down hard. Fortunately, no injury there. We see this kind of foul. Players going up above the shoulders with their arms and hands in a 3-0 three-goal consolation game. Already three card accumulation for Rene Loya. Part of that scrum last night against the Iowa Demon Hawks as well. Game got a little bit out of control, and he's on three cards today. Referees trying their best to deal with it, but some of this, you know, really needs to be on the players to police it themselves. And that not just the other team, your own teammates, because once these things start happening, do they stop? It's he did, so I did, now he did, so this guy does, and eventually, do we end up in a fight, or do we end up with an injured player? Hopefully neither, maybe both. Kevin Tenney, side to side with Lucio. Lucio to Rashad Amadi. Amadi trying to fit that ball in. Great clearance there from Benji Monreal, starting Wichita all the way over. Wichita really struggling to get this thing. Haven't ever got it back to level. Scored first, been trailing the rest of the game. Have got it to one, have got it to two, back to three, back to two. Trying to get it back to two right now with less than 4 minutes left in the game and try to be within striking distance. Can't imagine either team wants overtime. The league doesn't have a game that ends in tie, but if there could be one, I'm sure they'd all appreciate it being this one. If not, maybe we just flip a coin or go to penalties or shootouts. I'll have to get with Deputy Commissioner Andrew Ross on that one. He's kind of leads up dealing with the Rules Committee people. I think they would all agree that this last 3 minutes and 36 seconds would be plenty for this match. We'll be right back with you. We're going to take a break. Stay tuned afterwards for the 4 p.m. M2 final between Rochester and Iowa Demon Hawks.
If your bank ain't Texas family owned, then it ain't for you, old son. If your bank doesn't walk your grandmother to her car, if you don't hear a Texas accent when you call,
if your bank doesn't deliver awesome customer service
more than it delivers BS, then it ain't for nobody, old son. Sounds like you need to bank with Amarillo National.
And cut.
Whew, that felt good. Be careful, I might take your job.
At IHOP, we're flipping up more than pancakes with our new menu featuring waffles, biscuits, burgers, Benedicts, and more. There's always a way to put a smile on your plate. Only at IHOP. Download the app and earn free food with every order.
Guided by its values of doing the right thing, putting people first and reaching higher. Cargill Proteins is committed to making an impact in Wichita community because Crown Cargill.
3 minutes, 36 seconds left. We're back here at Hartman Arena. Wichita Wings trailing 10-7. Wichita on a power play. They've already given up a shorthanded goal. Here's Benji Monreal getting forward. He's done really well he's a great power play guy, but he's done really well on the penalty kill. Benji gets the edge of Taylor's ankle and their old teammates, so Benji helps him up, and Taylor says, I know you didn't intend to do that. Good stuff from those two. Benji, former Wichita Wings player, played here as well with the Chihuahua Savage a few times. Fan favorite in Wichita, Kansas is Benji Montreal. Tenney side to side with Rashad. Rashad down low to Henry. Henry tries to play across to Robbins, but mishits it. That's off the boards. Bouncing to Montreal. Rashad Amadi back. Benji gets a shot off, puts it across goal. Tenney tangled up there with Jorge Gonzalez and fouls Gonzalez. Wichita, 14 seconds left on this power play. Very tired legs from the Wichita Wings today. And honestly, not anything productive coming out of these power plays. They're minus a goal on their own power play so far in this game. I apologize. Correction. Look down, the first goal of the game where Lucio found Henry, second post. Good save from Parrott. Pushes it back. Monreal, Valenzuela. They're going to kill this penalty, and in comes Kevin Machado in just a few seconds. 2-1, Machado. He's in, and this is going to catch Marshawn Amadi by surprise. It has, and hopefully he opts out of that. That's a very dangerous moment, and certainly somebody can say something to Marshawn Amadi so he doesn't turn into that challenge as Machado steps out of the penalty box. Good thing it didn't get any worse than it was. Timeout for Wichita. We'll see if the Wichita Wings opt to go with the sixth attacker, and it looks like they just might. Down three goals, 2 minutes, 14 seconds left. Timeout, Wichita. We'll be back in 1 minute. We're back for the final 2 minutes and 14 seconds of the season for the Amarillo Bombers and the Wichita Wings in this third place consolation game between the number 3 seed Wichita Wings and number 5 seed Amarillo Bombers. Both lost yesterday in the semifinals. Wichita has went to Taylor Henry, who's dressed somewhat of a Miami Dolphin right now. You're looking who that is. Wearing the number 0 jersey is a sixth man. Taylor Henry is going to be the sixth attacker for Wichita. He's going to have to commit to that one, and he does. Smashes it forward back from Dantes, headed back to Henry Dantes. Dantes going forward, flicked on by Robbins. He controls and tries to play it backwards. Header to Henry, puts Henry into another moment where he has to decide if he's going to get into a challenge. And now side to side, Wichita, sixth man. Minute 30 seconds left. David Lucio, Dantes tries to flick it across. Chavez saves it after a deflection from Machado. And now they're trying to run with Carrasco. Tenike plays it back to Parrott. Parrott to Lucio. Parrott's going to try to sub. He interchanges. Back comes the sixth man for Taylor Henry. Great change between Henry and Parrott. 1 minute left. Henry. Marshawn Amadi, why not? Saved by Machado, but if anybody deserves another one here, let's see Marshawn Amadi add to his highlight reel. 45 seconds. Love the kid. He's been great in Wichita as a player, been great as a person. Excited to have him back for year two of his two-year contract next season. Marshawn hits that off the post. That's Robbins. Cleared into Carrasco. Carrasco off the outside of his boot. Says, why not me get one more before the end of this? And they're still trying to score. Up three. Wichita with an advantage due to the sixth attacker. A little bit late from Lucio. 17, 16. Down to 16.2 left in the Wichita season. They're fighting to the very end. Kevin Tenite into Robbins. Robbins. Henry. Henry misses that one. Plays it back to Dantas. And they're just going to kill this timeout. No, Henry's still combining. 2 seconds, 1 second. Rashad Ahmadi, and Rashad Ahmadi takes a shot near post, saved by Chavez. Wichita 7, Amarillo Bombers 10. That's it for the season for these two. Two great organizations have been in the semifinals 2 years in a row. Congratulations to the Amarillo Bombers and their fans for their second straight appearance in the playoffs, into the playoff semifinals, I should say. Same for the Wichita Wings. Both put on great performances yesterday. We appreciate the effort that it takes after losing those emotional games to come out and put together 17 goals in front of this fan base. For those that showed up, thank you to the Wichita Wings fans on behalf of our organization. For those of you that came out and appreciated the work that these guys put in all year, thank you for supporting them on an early Sunday game. Thank you for tuning in if you're watching and supporting the team. We appreciate your support. The team will be back next year, ready to go. But last year, use that game as momentum into this season, and hopefully using a difficult semifinal loss to propel this team into the next level for next year in Wichita. Still probing, since 1979, had a special, special fan base, a special culture, special players. Still looking for that first championship for the Wichita Wings. Wichita Wings, we will be back and we will be hunting. We're gonna take a break. At 4 p.m., we hope that you'll watch, because the M2 final, the M2 championship is appetizing. Number one seed, Iowa Demon Hawks. Number two seed, Rochester Lancers. Both unbeaten. We'll come back about 20 minutes before that one for a pregame talk. We will have a solo stream for that game. This stream, you'll still find us on YouTube, but we're gonna have a solo individual stream for the M2 National Final, again, coming at you, kickoff at 4 p.m. We'll start 20, 30 minutes prior to that with the pregame show. Thank you, Wings fans. Thank you, Bombers fans. Thank you, indoor soccer fans. Signing out for the MASL2, I'm Blake Shoemaker. We'll be back here for the 4 p.m. kickoff.